Yahoo! Misa named Jar Jar Binks. My the most famous Gungan in all of the Naboo. Usually listen to the Three Sheets to the Mouse podcast. It's the biggest bombad podcast in all of the galaxy. Mine thinks keep you sa younglings away from it. This guy's no good. Just like in the prequels.
Sorted, but you'll be rewarded when at last I am given my dues. And injustice deliciously squared, be prevailed.
Hello, everyone. Welcome to episode number 295 of Three Sheets to the Mouse, where the podcast likes to focus on the adult side of Disney, from parks to movies to dining. We'll cover everything Disney has to offer, including their drinks. My name is Mikey, and this evening I am joined by Adam.
Yo,
Mark.
What's up?
And the birthday girl, Lauren.
Hello.
Happy birthday.
Thank you.
Welcome to your mid-30s.
Yes.
Well, she already had the mid-30s. It's all downhill from here. It's late 30s now.
Oh, yeah, you're
well,
screwed.
I mean, she's entering the late 30s, and the top of that hill gets so much faster every day. It's every day seems a little close. Anyway,
I'm gonna take a bath with a toaster.
No, it's bath with a fucking toaster.
So enjoy it while you can, and you are.
I am. Thank you,
Adam. What are you drinking tonight?
I just got some beer because I don't want to get too drunk because I still have to fucking work tomorrow. So I have a few beers from the Trokes case. Their summer series. I have the shouldn't have got this one either. Fuck, I can't talk. Sunshine Pilsner. And I don't know what else I have. I just grabbed shit out of the fridge.
you threw it a cooler and brought it upstairs, right?
Pretty much.
That's it. How about you, Mark?
I've got myself a new one I haven't tried yet. It's a bottle of Noble Oak Double Oak Rye, finished in port wine oak staves. First time I got it, I think it was about $40, and it's really good. I like it. Nice and smooth.
Good. Good. Okay. And Lauren, you've got.
I am currently drinking a warm Corona Light.
Warm. That's the
Which is
way,
the best
ooh.
Way to have your Corona.
I disagree.
I think.
The best way to have
Corona is
a different beer.
Ice cold on a beach, but, you know, I have
different
neither
beer.
Of those things.
Why is it warm?
Because I didn't put it in the fridge.
Wait, what?
Because I didn't put it in the fridge.
You like warm beer?
Are you British?
No. I was just really lazy.
Beer are like fish. They have to acclimate.
Yeah.
You've got to put it in the fridge.
I am putting it out of its misery as fast as I can, okay?
All right, Mikey, what do you got?
I have got half a lap full of Lagavulin because I spilled my Glencairn before we recorded and panicked everybody.
What you posted in our chat
was not that.
No.
Was definitely not I spilled my drink.
It was major problem making us think like the house is on fire or something.
Hospital trip, you know.
I mean, it smells like charcoal, so it smells like it was on fire, I guess. I got plenty left in the Glencairn. I'm going to have a good show with this Nick Offerman Lagavulin, so that's what I'm drinking.
Did you wring out your pants over the cup? Tell the truth.
I didn't. I took a beat and just sat here angry. Like, when you're so mad, you're quiet and you're completely still. That's kind of where my mind went immediately, and then I got up and trudged through the house with everybody looking at me like, oh my god, what's that smell?
Oh, it's just Mikey.
Oh, it's just that. You normally smell like that.
Oh, god. Yeah.
Cleaned up. Just threw all my clothes in the laundry room floor because Smiley's here washing laundry, and I'm like, well, that's a fire hazard now because that's going to go up like a Roman candle if a spark hits it, but whatever. Then I probably won't even message you guys, let you know something's wrong. I'll just let the flames take me.
How do you do laundry by the fire?
No, this is Arkansas wiring. Fire could be anywhere.
Okay. Well, I'm like, oh, he was doing laundry, and I was walking through, and there's a chance of me going off like a Roman candle. I'm like, does he burn his clothes to clean them? He
boils them, like in 1890.
Ah.
Right?
Then smacks them up against the rock.
Yeah, although it would be Stephanie doing it, really. In 1890.
Oh, she'd have been drowned as a witch way before that. She's a strong-willed woman. Burn her! And I'll be like, yes, wrap my clothes around her. She'll go up quickly.
What accent was that?
That's like trying to go Irish or something.
Not entirely sure. It actually sounded like 1930s Midwestern Chicago. I sounded like some guy.
You sounded like a leprechaun on crack is what that sounded
like. What's that? Gangs of New York. That's what it was.
Yeah, that's me. I sounded just like Daniel Day-Lewis right there.
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm. Dead ringer.
So enough talk about The Rocketeer. The 30s, that was kind of the same era. And speaking of the 30s, Mark's taking us back, and we're going to get to the 30s.
Not that far back. It's only 58.
I was just going to say.
Mikey didn't do his homework.
Mikey did his homework, but he's screwing up.
Very badly.
That tracks. I do my own show. We talked about this earlier.
Yes, but like the 1930s, I'm like, what?
Starting with Snow White and the Seven Dwarves in the 1930s, Walt Disney Studios, something, something, something.
No, we had this idea earlier this week of taking a look at some of the music that are within some of our favorite Disney attractions. And I decided, hey, what's like one of the most prolific songs in the history of Disney theme parks that isn't Haunted Mansion or Pirates of the Caribbean? And that would be from the Carousel of Progress. And it just so happened that Mark had prepared a doctoral thesis on that ride a year ago.
Oh, yeah.
And he's like, oh, I got this. And that's kind of what we're going to be looking at is, you know, the history, the music, the talent of the music of Carousel of Progress, which I've only recently discovered.
Like I said, just fuck.
I've done it once. So, Mark, take it away, bud.
Right. So, like Mikey just said, we're talking about Carousel of Progress and the music with it. This has been my favorite attraction at Disney World and really any Disney attraction that I've had the pleasure of experiencing. She's been through a lot of changes, but she's always been about progress, and we're going to take a look at the music. Before we get into that, we're going to take a moment and talk about the genesis, so to speak, because originally Carousel of Progress was starting out as part of an expansion to Disneyland called Edison Square, and it was going to be known as Harnessing the Lightning and was going to be a walkthrough attraction. And it was going to be very similar to Carousel of Progress, where if you actually go and look at it, a lot of the scenes were going to be very, very similar. But after a while, Disney had dropped the idea for Edison Square for one reason or another. But it was partly also the fact that he wasn't sure that the technology for animatronics at the time would be up to the task. And so he just kind of shelved the idea. And then GE, whenever they're trying to come up with their pavilion for the World's Fair, they decided to approach Disney because he was already working on three other attractions. And they went with Disney because GE had a bit of a price fixing scandal going on at the time. And were fined $500,000 with an additional $50 million that were having to be paid to the utilities that had purchased that equipment.
Is that prorated to today's currency? Like today's money?
That I didn't find. It didn't mention that. But if that would be a massive amount.
Because that seems like it would bankrupt a company.
you would think, but you know, here they are, you know,
I mean, when you're talking about that kind, I don't even think they used those numbers.
they probably didn't.
You're just making up numbers now.
Finally, you know, everything came together, and you know, Walt said yes, and he approached the Sherman Brothers like he did for a lot of his music back then. You know, we know, you know, them for Mary Poppins and one of the things they came up with There's a Great Big Beautiful Tomorrow, a song most people associated with the attraction. At this point, I'm going to go ahead and hand it over to Mikey and let him talk more about the attraction at the World's Fair.
Yeah, so the People Mover was established as a... Okay, sorry, wrong notes. I'm kidding! Ha ha! I'm just trying to give Adam an aneurysm, and I think I succeeded. So, yeah, like Mark mentioned, when Walt had this idea for the Carousel of Progress, it was going to go there in Disneyland. And in the early versions of this attraction, before it kind of got fleshed out for the World's Fair, they had considered the soundtrack to use various popular songs from each time period depicted. So, for instance, in the early 1900s, they had looked at a song called Bird in a Gilded Cage, which was a banger, by the way. You'll want to go check that out. In the 20s, they had looked at a song called Barney Google. And I haven't listened to either of these, so I couldn't tell you what they sounded like. But I think they made the better decision to kind of have the Sherman Brothers bring it all together with one singular song, a lot like the way they did it with another World's Fair ride, which would have been Small World. You can have those guys in your back pocket. You're kind of made. So Walt hit up the Sherman Brothers and asked them to make that song that would tell the story of the attraction without giving away what was happening in the overall scheme of things, but still kind of capture the essence, spirit of the Progress Land Pavilion that GE was sponsoring there. And the Brothers Sherman came up with what half the listening audience is already humming in their head. There's a great big beautiful tomorrow. And they were able to adapt that to various musical styles that were popular in each of the eras that were represented throughout the attraction. So instead of having different songs to represent the different eras, because musically that's what, you know, yeah, you can see as everything spins, or as you spin around the different sets, you can see the different set pieces and the appliances and stuff. And that kind of gives you an idea of what era you're in. But really the music, like, and that's just almost an emotional connection with the audience. So having the same song presented in different ways is ultimately what tied the entire attraction together. And it only took just a couple days for Sherman Brothers to get that cranked out. And Walt says he liked it, and he asked Sherman Brothers to roll up to a soundstage dressed in their finest suits, because they had to film a performance of the song while actually singing it alongside Walt Disney. And that film is what got sent to the GE executives to get the green light on having that in the attraction. Now, it's one thing to write the song, but the different eras last different amounts of time, and you've got entrance and you got exit, and you got to take that tune and stretch it out. Maybe you got to truncate it down a little bit. So Disney hired or called on his best composer, Buddy Baker, who has actually composed or had actually composed over 200 songs for Walt Disney. And he was able to adapt that tune into the different styles to match the different times, but also to work as the loading and exit music so it could loop endlessly and so on and so forth. But after two seasons of running at the World's Fair, the attraction went from 64 to 65. They gave the Carousel of Progress a break. Old Uncle finally got his privacy.
Old Uncle Orville.
Uncle Orville finally got his privacy, and it took 2 years off before they got it shipped over to Disneyland's newly themed Tomorrowland there in 67. So going back to the music of the World's Fair, Buddy Baker didn't just help Disney with the soundtrack on Carousel of Progress. He also composed music for the attraction that Disney created that was located right above the Carousel of Progress, which you would leave the Carousel of Progress and you could exit the theater altogether, or you could just go up a flight of stairs into what was called the Sky Dome Spectacular.
Thank God. And you know what I thought he was going to say, right?
Yeah.
I thought for sure he was coming out with the fucking people mover again. I would have to smack him across the TV.
This is the People Mover podcast.
It would have been the Skyway, actually, which was sponsored by Ford. And that's not what we're talking about here. No, the Sky Dome Spectacular was a GE-sponsored, I guess it was like a show, really. To be quite honest, it reminded me a lot of O Canada, because I don't think there was any seating. You just kind of stood up and leaned back, and you watched this whole show projected on the domed roof of the theater. And it was basically different images of nature and different types of energies and how they interact being shown on the roof or on the ceiling. You had lightning, you had sun, and a whole lot of other, you know, GE just promoting where the energy is going in the future and solar and stuff like that. But that ended the contribution from Disney and the Sherman Brothers and everything into the World's Fair in the 60s for Carousel of Progress.
I do have some more stuff on the music. Rex Allen, who was also the original voice for Father, also, you know, for obvious reasons, he was the recorded the song as well.
He's the singing cowboy.
Yes. And I found him to be very similar to Gene Shepherd, who is the current voice of Father.
When did they re-record it?
They have been re-recording it a few times.
Yeah, 93, 94 is whenever Gene Shepherd came in for that refurb.
Oh, yeah.
This version of the song, you know, is the same version. It remained whenever the attraction was at the World's Fair all the way through its Disneyland run. Also, like after the show, whenever it moved to Disneyland, instead of seeing the Sky Dome Spectacular, guests would still go upstairs. They would see a model of Progress City / Epcot, mm-hmm. and leading up to the top floor, they would also hear a modified score of Great Big Beautiful Tomorrow called Progress March. It sounded like a faster paced, more upbeat version of it. And whenever they were viewing the model, there was also another score. It was called like Progress City, and hear that while the concept behind Epcot and Progress City was being described to them. Dick Sherman, he was once quoted as saying the song had a wonderful positiveness about it, and in a way was Walt's theme song because he was always so positive and optimistic about the future and technology. And Marty Sklar was also even quoted in an interview saying pretty much the same thing, where like Walt was an eternal optimist and he really believed that things could be better. And Richard and Bob Sherman wrote the song as a personal ode to Walt. They always consider that Walt's anthem and always, you know, try to recognize that. Yeah, that's the end of my spot, or the end of the rest of that spot.
Fair enough.
My second spot.
I have to preempt this with saying that this song did not last when it made its way over to Disney World. So the song was also written by the Sherman Brothers and was commissioned by GE because GE wanted people to focus on the here and now rather than wait for tomorrow. The song that we ended up with was Now Is the Time, Now Is the Time, Now Is the Best Time of Your Life, which people are actually reading some of the comments when I was doing my research, didn't know that this was not the original song, that they thought that this was the original song and you couldn't tell them any different.
Maybe they're having their own Mandela effect.
Well, no, because if you think about from 69, it was in California. People weren't traveling to California to go see this if you didn't see it at the World's Fair.
Exactly.
So a lot of people's first time experience for this attraction was in Disney World.
That was a tough song. I tried listening to it and I just...
You see, I grew up with this though.
To me, it wasn't an earworm like...
Oh, yeah, for sure.
If you grow up with it, you know this song. If you've gone to the parks, if you've seen the attraction back then, you know the song.
I've definitely heard that song. It's even in the background music in Tomorrowland.
Mm-hmm.
Correct.
Mm-hmm.
They digitalized it a bit, but it's not the same exact version, but yes. All right. So I actually took some time and actually watched a few videos on a version from 1992. Took some notes, and the first transition of the song, you first hear it, it's sort of like the show tune song. There's nothing very grand about it, nothing very memorable about it. And you have that first transition when the theater starts turning, and we go into the first scene, which kind of takes the song to like a 1900s feel. John hums a bit of the song after the transition. The talking machine, which is early like recorded devices, plays a bit of the song in this kind of weird operatic kind of theme, which is interesting to hear. Jane hums the bit of the song as well, and this is the only scene that I found where the actual backing track to the attraction starts towards the end. So if you never notice a lot of Disney attractions, they will have music throughout the whole show from start to end. Either if it's very faint or you don't really notice it that much because it's built into that transaction so much. I took a really careful listen. This didn't have theme music until the very end. Then we go into the second transition, which we go from the 1900s to the 1920s. We have the classic theme of the nasally girl group singers from that time area. Think of Al Adams, though I think he's rather tasty lyrically, is the best way I can explain it. This slowly fades into an instrumental version that until the actual appliances start singing their little song where everybody knows what they start going crazy, that's where the actual background music stops again. A phonograph is introduced,
for the first time, and we actually have a jazzy version of A Great Big Beautiful Tomorrow, which I wouldn't mind hearing the full version of this song, but I don't know if that's available anywhere. And, you know, of course, it's the 20s, so the kids are going crazy for jazz.
Of course.
The third transition goes from the 1920s to the 1940s, and this kind of reminds me of that big band sound a little bit more than any of the others do. The instrumental that happens right after the main part is considerably slower than the main theme, and again, we have a transition where the music just stops about halfway through when we talk about Grandma and Grandpa, where we hear a bit of noise that sounds like an old-time movie music, and that's because they're watching something on the TV, and when Grandma switches to the fights, the music just cuts out. The wife, Sarah, hums the main theme while working in the rumpus room, which is just a fucking fun word to say.
Rumpus.
And this is my first audio cue that I remember from Disney that went, oh, okay, this is almost like a snapback, because as Sarah asks, because she's working on the rumpus room, she has her mixer going and she's hanging up the wallpaper, and Sarah asks John, if you hired a man to do this job, wouldn't you pay him? John answers, yes. Sarah says, then should I get equal pay? John chuckles, well, we might negotiate something later on. Sarah says when, and the cuckoo clock just happens to go off and start singing, now is the time. it's just like, it's little things like this. Of course, John snaps back at the cuckoo clock and says, you stay out of this. So there's a lot of, like, if you really dissect these, especially for the time period that they're talking about, makes a lot of sense. From 1940s, we jump all the way to New Year's Eve in the 70s. Boy, do we go up. Just looking at this scene, yes, I remember a lot of this crap technology. You had the big screen TV, but it was a rear projection big screen TV. So if you don't know what that is, you all want to look it up. It's a mess. The son is playing on the electric guitar, as one does in the 70s, and the whole family singing the song. However, I thought that was pretty bad until we get to the end. And this is the final transition from the 1970s to wherever the hell they thought this was going to end up. My actual note says, I have no words. The description I put was, it kind of sounds like the Hercules singers doing a porn tunish version of Now Is the Time. Because you have that weird 70s porn guitar going on. They're singing over that track and there are fireworks. And I'm like, yeah. That's pretty much the rundown of that particular show with all the musical cues and all that. So now, some interesting facts. Even though GE dropped their sponsorship back in 1985, it wasn't until around 1994 when There's a Great Big Beautiful Tomorrow made its return. And it was actually sung by Gene Shepherd. And that's all I got for that.
I haven't seen the old footage of the ride. I'm just familiar with the contemporary version of it. I think they've updated a little bit since my first time to go see it back in 2014. The last scene always seems to be the one that just cracks people up. Where in your case, it was wow.
Yeah, it was just because when you think about this, they didn't really go into the future. They just kind of brought it current because Disney World opened in 1974. So all this technology was either up and coming or already really out. So they didn't bring it to the future. They just kind of sort of brought it present, but very little bit present. It was like, this is outdated yesterday.
Yeah.
Because it's like, and now they brought it up to the future, but it's still the present now for what you see. Actually, it's like probably 5 years ago.
Well, to be fair, they did get rid of the Virtual Boy.
Did they?
Did they?
See, yes. I would have kept that because that's retro now. Granny still got game.
Yeah, Granny still got game, and it seems like the set is basically the same as it was in 93, 94, except they swapped out the rear projection big screen for a LCD TV.
I'm fine with that, but when you see this big old, like, rear projection TV, and you go, oh my god, I remember those.
Yeah, that's 700 pounds.
Well, easy. And Alexa mishears him, but it's not, oh, can you set my number two timer, and it says, I'll put your number soup timer. Instead, she turns the oven up to 1,000 degrees.
Yeah.
That's been part of the show since, when you think about 84-ish, what did I say? I don't know. 94?
Yeah, 94.
We didn't have that in 94.
No.
And that's funny, though, because that's just a normal thing now.
Yes.
It's available.
Yeah, because 94, we didn't have that. But I do remember that scene in 94 where he's yelling at the mm-hmm. oven. So I'm going to pass it over to Lauren.
No, please don't.
Who has the Easter eggs and some other fun facts.
Okay, I have the Easter eggs section. I don't know if these count as Easter eggs, but I'm going to read them all. Thank you, Martin.
You're welcome.
So, number one, apparently Rex Allen, who voices Father, was quoted as saying he was unaware what he was getting into when he was chosen to voice Father. I would love to know more about that.
Yeah, I would too, but I couldn't find anything else about that.
I mean, it was just voiceover work.
Yeah.
Yeah,
yeah,
well, he was
I mean.
Iconic in the World's Fair and stuff, but it's not like people saw him walking on the road with your John.
Well, that's what I mean.
Yeah.
It sounds like there's a story there.
It does, but...
It's probably more boring than what we're all making it out to be.
Probably.
Because,
yeah, kind of like me spilling my drink.
Yes.
Because when you think about how actors worked back then, they were signed to a studio for however many shows that they had to do or however mm-hmm. many bits that they had to do.
Yeah.
So whatever studio that he might have been working for, even if he was signed through Disney, this is what you're doing. They don't always tell them, or they didn't have to tell them what the project was. They didn't,
yeah.
He didn't get to choose at that point. He was under contract to do it.
Was he, I know you said this earlier, but did he do the original song? So maybe he wasn't aware he had to sing?
Yeah, that's a possibility.
I mean, his nickname was the Singing Cowboy, so... Yeah.
Well, there goes that theory, okay.
Now, he may not have realized that this was going to be for what was essentially a ride.
Yeah.
Maybe he thought it was, for, like I said, a voiceover for a movie or a cartoon character is what I would think he would think.
Next, in Iron Man 2, there is a model of Stark Expo, and there is a model of the original Progressland building in there. Richard Sherman was also hired to write the Stark Expo jingle for Iron Man 2. Listen to it and see if you can tell that it was written by him.
You know I've got...
Yeah.
Yeah.
Play it.
Yeah.
Here, we're gonna edit it in.
Yeah, because there's... No, because I watched Iron Man 2. In fact, I just started watching the Iron Man movies again. And
why would you watch that one, though?
ScarJo.
Because I'd watched Iron Man 1, and I wanted to watch Iron Man 2. And then
he's not as stupid as I am, who started the whole Avengers series over from day one. So
We've done that, too.
I am sorry.
But there's a section, it's part of the movie, and you hear the music. Immediately, you can tell that it's a Sherman song. Because I think at this point, Bob Sherman had passed away by the time Iron Man 2 came out. And then watching the credits, you hear the actual jingle itself and the lyrics and everything. And you can definitely tell that it was done by Richard Sherman.
Like, I can always tell when something's done by Hans Zimmer.
Yes.
Yeah.
Oh, my God.
It's like John Williams. I can pick that out of
him. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. He's another one that you can tell
every
really quickly.
Every time. Like, oh, that's definitely John Williams because it has the same melodies that he always uses.
Though not explicitly stated by Father, his newspaper states 1890 is the year, not the date, the year. Carousel of Progress operated at the World's Fair April 22nd, 1964 through October 18th, 1964, and then April 21st, 1965 through October 17th, 1965.
Yes, because it only runs from April to October at the mm-hmm. stupid World's Fairs.
So,
yeah.
Again, it kind of makes sense, like what I said before, that people's first experience, if they haven't been to California,
mm-hmm.
would have been that first song.
Yeah.
Yep.
For obvious reasons, all the appliances you see have the General Electric logo on them. About 200 people could be loaded every 4 minutes, but it was not unusual for the wait times to be 60 to 90 minutes during the World's Fair.
Holy crap.
Yeah.
Can you imagine waiting 90 minutes for this?
Yes.
But can you imagine, though, like, this doesn't exist? Well, like, this is...
I understand that. I don't think there's anything I'd wait 90 minutes for anymore.
Mm-mm.
Nothing?
No.
The attraction saw upwards of 41,000 people a day, with 16 million
Damn.
People total by the end of the World's Fair. During development, it was known as the Carousel Theater of Progress. I guess it was too wordy.
That is a lot of words.
And apparently, there was a third character in the end scene of the early version of the show, but they didn't speak. They were replaced early on with a cat laying on the couch next to Mother.
You know, that's just one of those points is like when you sit there and say, look, I'm in the movie, look, I'm in the movie, and they cut you from the movie.
And we replaced you with a cat.
And then the next section is other places the music can be heard and covers of the songs. So They Might Be Giants recorded a cover of There's a Great Big Beautiful Tomorrow as a bonus track for the soundtrack of the movie Meet the Robinsons, which I just want to say is an amazing movie.
It is a fun movie.
Yeah, it doesn't get the love it deserves.
That's because Disney forgot it exists.
Yes.
Well, Disney forgets a whole bunch of movies.
They do. Mm-hmm. Like, something does... Okay, I don't think it did well.
It did not.
Which is unfortunate. And that was like that weird time when Disney was kind of starting to get away from the kid movies and get more towards movies that...
I feel Meet the Robinsons is a kid movie, though.
Yeah.
There's like an existential element to it, though.
I mean, as opposed to Hunchback? I don't feel that's a kid's movie at all.
Well, no, because after that, they got back into kids.
Meet the Robinsons made me cry when I saw it.
I don't remember it that well.
I don't remember anything wanting to make me cry, except freaking Goob got treated like shit.
It was about, like, this kid who's an orphan, but he's really, really smart, and then this mysterious figure comes and, like, kidnaps him in a time machine, and it turns out it's his son.
Do you remember this movie? Because this is when I was working for Starbucks when I first saw it, and I just remember the lady with all the caffeine patches.
Relatable. Moving on. In 2015, ESPN used song, I assume, Great Big Beautiful Tomorrow, for a commercial featuring the NCAA football signing day. The commercial was for the ESPNU channel and featured baseball caps of major college football programs.
There was a commercial back in 2015, because I actually went and looked this up to verify this existed. It was a bunch of baseball caps lined up on a table, and you would hear the instrumental of Great Big Beautiful Tomorrow as it panned across the table.
Need to look this
up. I remember that, actually.
Yeah, it was just like a 30-second spot.
I know
spot.
I did it.
Yeah.
Sports ball. I remember seeing that.
I didn't know that happened. I was like, what the hell? I was like, really? What?
That is absolutely random.
Yes, it is.
And how many people watch ESPN and you for the commercial?
Not me.
You should post that in the group so we can see it.
Wow, she's just giving everybody work. Have you noticed? No. Adam,
yeah, right?
Cut this in. And Mark, post
I was
in
given
the group.
Mark's, like, 17-page thesis to learn today, okay? Song makes an appearance at the end of the short Fun with Mr. Future, sung by the titular character himself.
If you just want to say tit, you don't have to sneak it in. But you can just let the Tourette's fly,
it's better
Lauren.
Than,
it's fine.
It's better than Rumpus Room.
Yeah, Rumpus Room is a
I
fun one to say.
I actually went and looked this up, you know, do my research, and it's partially like an animated short.
Okay.
It's a live action slash animated short. Like, it's one of those where it's bookended by live action spots.
Sort of like the Alice shorts?
Kind of. And it's like, this is... Mr. Future is like this... It looks like an animatronic without the skin.
Oh,
so
oh,
it looks like the the stuff of nightmares. And my guess is more or less like kind of like what a kid's going to look forward to. And like the middle segments are like, you know, all animated and everything. Animation itself isn't that great. I just mainly looked at it just to verify that Great Big Beautiful Tomorrow is at the end of it. And like once the animated spots are finished and at the end of it, that's when, you know, Mr. Future comes online and says, hey, you know, start singing.
The song was featured in the movie Tomorrowland when George Clooney's character Frank visits the 1964 World's Fair.
See, I didn't realize the song was featured. I actually like this movie. I think I'm like one of the only people who actually
I like this movie too.
Movie.
I need to find it because
I
like
really enjoy it.
You think being a Disney movie, it'd be on Disney Plus? It's not.
I've watched it on Disney Plus.
I have a Tomorrowland pin from the movie, the orange one.
When Disney Plus came out, it wasn't there. Then it came to Disney Plus. Then it left Disney Plus, and it's like, what the fuck?
I think I might have it on Blu-ray. I think I don't remember it too clearly because I do remember the whole small world segment.
Yes.
So,
mm-hmm.
Yeah, it's been a while since I've seen it.
I enjoyed it. It was weird,
yeah.
I guess. It didn't.
I liked it.
I was
it.
Like, okay, it's about Tomorrowland.
It's
and it,
weird. It's quirky. It's fun. I love
it. Didn't really have anything to do with the land or that theme park at all that I could figure out.
It was a better movie than The Marvels. That's all I'm saying.
I will agree with you on that.
An electronic version can also be heard as part of the background music of Tomorrowland in both Disneyland and Magic Kingdom. And I added, Best Time of Your Life is also in the background music there. At least yes. in Disney World.
I think it's Disney World, Disneyland, and Tokyo/Hong Kong, too. I did look up the music itself that you can like find on YouTube and stuff. And from what it was on YouTube, both songs, like, I think it starts off with Great Big Beautiful Tomorrow, and then Time of Your Life comes in, like, right after it finishes in the standard loop.
I'll be honest, I feel like I heard Time of Your Life in the background music first, and then later...
It may be.
Just for me, personally, the first time I heard that theme was as part of the background music, and then later I heard the song and said, oh, that's where I know that from. All right. It's even used as an audio exhibit in the outdoor queue of Guardians of the Galaxy Mission Breakout.
This I didn't know.
Yeah, see, I didn't know that either. I'll admit, I mostly found that from the wiki.
Okay.
So I can't personally verify this.
Let's send Sarah to go investigate.
We've got people.
Yes.
Boots on the ground.
I will look for it. Well, I am going in August, so I will, if I remember to look, I'll try to look.
It's interesting that it says audio exhibit, so that kind of makes it sound like something that you'd have to, like, go up to and interact with.
That may just be part of what the collector calls it.
That's exactly it. So when you go into the attraction, you're going into the collector's museum.
Mm-hmm.
So it makes sense that it's an audio exhibit.
Yeah.
Find it, record it, bring it home. This recording, as well as Walt's original Epcot introduction, were included in the Tomorrowland DVD set of Walt Disney's treasures.
This I would like to find. Like the treasure boxes.
Yes. Yeah.
I only have two of them. I can't find the other ones.
I don't have any.
I don't have any of them.
I don't know what you're talking about.
So you don't have any either.
Correct.
They were tin boxes where they collected a few of the Walt Disney Treasures Wonderful World of Disney videos.
Okay.
So like the stuff that they used to air on TV.
Right.
They actually put them on DVD. Those are not on Disney Plus.
No.
At least I don't know how to look for them if they are.
It's convoluted anymore.
It's some classic stuff, like how he introduces Epcot and, like, all the clips that you see where you see him walking through. Like, you see actual Walt Disney pointing and talking to Mary Blair. A lot of those film clips were from those original shows that they just keep on kind of reusing and recycling.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay, so I guess we can all kind of agree that the music on Carousel of Progress is, like, top-notch production that has had immense staying power, even though... Honestly, it is. I don't mind having this stuck in my head on repeat more so than Small World, because I don't know. I just like the way it's sung and everything and how it goes. So I, because John, he's like your every dad. He's just kind of like, you know, it'll be okay.
Right.
I blew the whole neighborhood. It's fine.
Here's my naked daughter in the shower. It's right? died.
Well, she did have like a slip or something on, but you know, that's how we're friends, so it's okay.
Ladies showered back then. In slips.
Fully clothed.
She's doing her laundry and washing her body. Saving water.
There you go. But no chance of fire that way, Mikey.
That's correct.
Yeah.
That's it. So are there any other songs, I guess, that are kind of tops on your list in Disney? You know, because Adam mentioned, hey, what's everybody's like top five? I'm sitting here making this list and I'm like, well, everybody's going to say that. Everybody's going to say that. Everybody's going to say that.
I have a go with me that I don't think anybody has.
I just started looking at background music for my list.
Okay, obviously. Okay, the gimmies right off the bat is going to be the Haunted Mansion.
Of course.
But of course.
You're going to have Pirates. Yeah.
That's the Zippity-Doo-Dah.
It's gone.
What?
It's not in the parks
anymore. So we don't
anymore.
Include it anymore?
I mean, you can.
Oh, I think I would go with anything that's here or gone.
Okay, I do have some gone ones then, too, so mine are okay then.
Yeah, Adam's probably got Horizons.
No, I do not have Horizons.
Okay. Well, then, Adam, what do you have? Because
okay, so my first true go with me, because it's technically not an attraction, but it was the old resort TV music when you turned on the TV that just always made you feel like you were in Disney. I don't care what anybody says. If you ever stayed in the bubble, you know exactly what I'm talking about.
Right. Gives you all the warm and fuzzies.
I've got to go with me because it's also not an attraction. All right. Boo to you.
Oh, yes. Oh. Absolute earworm.
/ Hallowishes.
Happy Halloween.
They still do that parade?
Yeah.
I would hope so.
Well, they got rid of Hallowishes.
We did it whenever we did the day trip. right before the cruise last year.
That is just my favorite parade song that they've got. I just...
Disney actually does count parades and like shows as attractions.
Okay. Well, that one is like not my number one song, but I put it at number two on my little list because, you know, it wasn't quite what I was thinking of as an attraction. But damn it, I can listen to that soundtrack. And in October, I do listen to it many, 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 many times during the month. That's the first one I'm throwing out. Now someone else gets to go next.
This isn't in any particular order. Like at my number five, the Fantasyland music.
Okay.
Yeah, that loop there?
Yeah, the Fantasyland loop. I thought, you know, it's nice. It's fun. It's, you know, upbeat, peppy.
Yep, it's upbeat. I love the background music because almost always there's not like a vocal track or a lyric track to it. It's almost always instrumental, and that's just perfect for if you're working on a project, let that play.
Yep.
So you just got something, and if it's Fantasyland, it's a little peppy.
My problem is I start singing along to the damn songs.
Yeah, because it's all the songs you know. It's not like it's something crazy, so.
Yeah.
Lauren, you're up.
Okay, so mine are like ambient music, not necessarily ride music.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. The Star Tunnel in Space Mountain.
Okay.
You know what I'm talking about?
Yes,
I do.
I think so, yeah.
I finally was able to ride Space Mountain this last trip. Every time I've gone the last couple trips, it has been down. So, I
finally
wrote it a few times.
In the first time?
Hmm?
As in your first time?
No. I wrote it all the time.
No,
it's been almost...
For the first time in forever.
Pretty much. About 2 or 3 years.
Yeah. Who needs a ballroom with no balls? Yeah.
Speak for yourself.
Anyway.
Well, yeah, so...
So, how would you explain that music for people who don't know?
Oh, do you want me to? You want me to imitate it?
Yes.
Yes, that's exactly what he wants you to do.
You know, like the pew pew pew. It's like that, but pew 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 pew. I really hope my mic didn't
with
pick
like
that
a
up.
It was awesome. I love it.
I guarantee you, it picked it up.
If I have to boost the audio, it will.
just put like a phaser effect on it. and that's it.
For me, my next one, it's a Disneyland one. And this is the Paint the Night soundtrack from that parade.
Mm.
And, oh, I can't remember the name of the band right now, but it was at the end of Big Hero 6, I think it was. Owl City? Does that sound right?
Yes, it does.
Yes, that is correct.
And it's the When Can I See You Again? But it's...
When can but I
it's
see you
all
again?
All mixed in with all the Disney music, and that parade was mind blowing. I don't know if it's still there or not, but holy crap, it's such a good soundtrack and such a fun parade.
I used to have that song on my light show that I do at Christmas and Halloween, and it was sung by the different Disney princesses.
Oh, that's cool.
Oh, nice.
They were real people cosplaying as Disney princesses or
but
whatever.
Still.
And like a stormtrooper makes an appearance.
Of course.
And then one of the little girls is dressed up like Vanellope that's singing it. So she's kind of like the glitch making all this stuff go crazy. It's super cute. I'll find the video and I'll share it. But yeah, that's a good song.
I'm trying to remember the last time that Paint the Night was at Disney World. Because
Paint the
like,
Night has never made it to Disney World.
It hasn't? Okay,
no.
Then.
There was rumors that it was going to.
Because they lost the electrical...
Correct.
Parade or whatever. Okay.
The electric
That's
parade,
what I'm
which
thinking
is also
of.
On
yeah.
my list.
Mm-hmm.
But there was rumors that they were trying to get it to, but they said the floats were too heavy, and I don't know how much of that I believe.
Yeah.
Aren't they just sitting outside rotting
no,
away?
I mean, these were a huge... Tech.
Oh, you're talking about
yeah.
Paint the Night. I was thinking Spectra Magic.
Oh, Spectra Magic was
electric,
broken down.
Electric
there is nothing
parade,
left of Spectra Magic. Spectra Magic, okay.
Okay.
Let me school you a little bit. So, first nighttime parade was the Main Street Electrical Parade. Electric Light
That's
Parade.
That's the one I'm thinking of.
Yes.
Yeah.
After that was Spectra. Might have been something in between. Then it went back to the Main Street Electrical Parade for a while.
Yeah.
Spectra is totally destroyed. There, none of the floats were kept. They actually sold off pieces of some of them. It's a fucking crazy story with that parade. Paint the Night was allegedly coming here, but they said no. If they brought Paint the Night here, that would be a trip.
that I would just make to go see that show.
A day trip, whatever the hell it is, if I had to spend 24 hours and sleep in a car somewhere, that would be the time I would do
it. What's funny is, like, I told Tamara way back when that if they ever do fully get rid of Carousel of Progress, I will make a trip specifically to do that, even if it's for a day. Like, I drive down that day, go, and come back home. I would make a trip for that.
I get that. Are you out, Hank?
Just going to go and drop this out there to make sure no one else claims it, I guess. Soaring over California.
Fuck you, Mikey. Oh,
I didn't even think about that one.
Hey, Maria's not here. Can I say?
Yes.
That the new Soaring is not good, music-wise?
It's not. Okay. It's not good.
Anything.
It's not good visually.
Yeah, because we went and visited some friends in California, and we also turned it into a Disneyland trip.
Nice.
As one does.
It was my first time going to Disneyland, and I will say there are certain rides that are above.
Every single one.
Haunted Mansion is a toss-up because it was Haunted Mansion Holiday.
They win. They win because they have the overlay.
Yeah, I will admit that. We rode Soarin', and I straight up warned them. It's like, you're going to see the freaking curved penis Eiffel Tower. They're like, wait, what? I think we were on the second row all the way on the right. So you catch the worst of it. And they're like, we got off of it. They're like, yeah, I know what you're talking about.
It's just too much CGI. That's not.
Well, that's the other problem with
yes,
it.
That's not the
agreed.
Point of it.
The entire film was CGI, I think.
The whole thing isn't.
All the transitions.
Yeah, no,
every single transition is.
They didn't have rights to fly a drone over the Taj Mahal. So that whole thing is CG.
But I can forgive that. Because they would never get rights to fly over the Taj Mahal. But the transition scenes.
The orcas and the polar bears.
They pick a different thing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That's what I'm saying. It just doesn't work.
Just because you can.
Doesn't mean
you
should. Correct.
All right. Me?
Yes, you, sir.
Okay. My number four, I went with Pandora music.
That was on my short list. I agree with you, Mark. Because it's pretty chill and laid back.
That's why I picked it. It's like it's just chill and laid back and just sit back, relax, and just kind of chill out.
Especially at night. It really fits at night.
Oh, yes.
Oh, my gosh. I would love an overnight just camp there.
Lauren, you're up.
Yay.
Don't sound too excited.
Illuminations. I claim all of Illuminations. The before, the during, the after, the Tapestry of Nations, all of it. I love it.
Oh, Tapestry.
I
missed. That's the parade that should be interesting to watch again.
Yeah. I just love the giant fireball.
Yeah.
Yeah. I still haven't seen the new show.
The flame embargo.
Even like the beginning of the pre-show music and they would light all the torches around World Showcase. I mean, that's like core memory kind of thing for me.
Yeah,
just listening to Winnie the Pooh talk to you.
Yeah.
No, really?
I think it might be. It sounds like him.
It's the same voice. Yeah. About what's your next song? Next music.
I'm going to take all the songs from Guardians of the Galaxy.
Yeah, I knew somebody would.
I haven't had a chance to ride that one yet.
Which songs have you gotten?
All of them.
All of them.
Mm-hmm.
I've only ridden it one time.
I've gotten September. I've gotten.
That's what I got.
Conga?
Conga. I've gotten Tears for Fears. I know I got all of them. I can't think of all of them off the top of my head.
Because it's what? Four songs?
Tears for Fears is like the Holy Grail.
What?
Four songs?
Which one's that one?
I think there's four or five. I don't remember. You know I have all of them.
Yeah.
Tears for Fears is kind of like the Holy Grail. Like everybody wants that song.
It is such a different ride experience when you ride that attraction song.
It's so much slower.
Is that the Everybody Wants to Rule the World song?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. That
was the first
one I got. And I was like, I'm floating through space. And then I've never gotten it since.
It's such a different feel. It is such a great song. And you wouldn't think it fits with the ride because of all the other fast songs they have with it. But, oh my God, it changes the whole attraction.
It's so good.
Good pick, Adam. You took a lot of mine. I'm a homer. And I'm going to have to say, for one of mine, I love that Living with the Land little guitar song.
Dang it,
they play.
Mikey. Just gonna cross that off.
I found like a 2-hour loop on YouTube of just that little. I think it's mostly at the end now on your way out. But it's just I love it. Oh, I love it. I love when that starts playing. Yes, I would. Damn it.
Because you don't know the original song.
I know it was like, listen with the
or
land.
Listen to the land. Listen
to the land. To the land? Yeah. No, I don't know that. So, you know.
Sorry.
Well,
just disappointed. I am just disappointed.
Can you sing it for us, Adam, please?
No, I can't. Sorry. I don't know the words.
Are you sure?
Of course I'm lying, but I won't sing it.
All right, Mark.
Sunset Boulevard for my next one. It's got like that 40s big band style music. It's something about that, you know, style of music, honestly.
Lots of brass and
almost haunted
kind of
feeling.
Kind of like a big band kind of thing,
exactly.
Almost. But not, maybe not as heavy on the drums and stuff. Mm-hmm. Yeah, no, it's
like the glory days of Hollywood music.
Yeah. There's certain musical lines or instrumental segments that you hear that just make you think immediately of just, you know, the golden era of Hollywood, you know. Yeah, Sunset Boulevard, that's just great. That's why
the
Hollywood Studios it's just kind of one of my low-key favorite places to be of an evening when all the neon is on and they've gone out there and they've hosed down the streets. Who's up now?
It is Laura.
Mark just went, Lauren.
Since you stole, I was going to say Living with the Land, just all of it, which is another half-hour endeavor.
Yes.
The cue music for Pirates of the Caribbean.
All right.
It's like, yes, definitely. You
know? And there's like the lone clarinet.
I could put
that on and I'm there immediately.
Mm-hmm.
The smell.
Oh, the smell of pirate's water.
If they still do this during the Halloween parties, when they had the live pirates in the Pirates of the Caribbean, it was so much fun.
They didn't have it last year.
So cool. It was really, really
That's
cool.
Awesome.
It was fantastic. But I don't remember them having it last year.
The other thing about pirates, so once upon a time, back before Disney After Hours and all that shit, I was there beginning of December. The park was open till like 1 in the morning, and I was riding all the rides over and over and over. And I went on Pirates of the Caribbean. It was the last, like, we're all sprinting, and the cast member's like, go, go, go. You're going to get in before, like, the last minute. And, you know, he cuts the line off behind us. We're in line. We're in there. And this dude in front of us has a turkey leg.
It
was late. Christmas? Midnight?
Smell.
Yes.
And it's this guy at midnight with the turkey leg.
Picture it. Sicily.
Very late. Christmas. Very late. And
as you
the cast member let him bring it on the ride with us. And we're just on the fucking ride. And as we get down the hill, the whole boat goes, turkey leg! As the dude holds it over his head. It's just one of my favorite Disney memories.
All right. So, I guess my last song would be Life Would Be a Dream. And the reason why I chose this is for Cars Land.
Does it play at Art of Animation?
I couldn't tell you if they play it at Art of Animation, but at Disneyland, in Cars Land, at sunset, all the neon turns on, and they play Life Could Be a Dream. And just thinking about it actually gives me chills.
Yeah.
It is one of the most immersive lands that Disney has built in the U.S. parks in a very long time. And it's still, hands down, one of my all-time favorite experiences I've had in Disneyland.
Yeah. In fact, I would go so far as to say that Radiator Springs Racers is better than Test Track.
Again, every ride in California that we have a duplicate of in Disney World is better in Disneyland.
Yeah.
Much better.
Hands down.
Except Space Mountain.
Oh, no.
No, I will fight you on that. Space Mountain in California is better than Disney World.
100%
I will die on that deal.
Same.
No.
But does it have Lauren's pew pew pews?
Nope.
It has it has overlays.
Yeah.
Yeah.
For the holidays.
When I went out, it was Hyperspace Mountain when I went.
The ride is smoother.
That's what's bad about it.
I don't want to get a kidney stone knocked loose.
I need to feel like I'm afraid for my life while I'm on it.
Okay.
It's a thrill ride.
But
wait till she gets whiplash from like one of them rides. And
hey, I'm only 35, okay?
Yeah, oh, yeah. Oh,
sweetie,
you're getting
when it
close.
Starts.
You're getting close. I think I've shown this picture a couple of times of the picture of Tamara basically about to be in tears on Everest. So it's kind of a chore to get her own coasters. even whenever I explained to her, no, this is not.
That's just mean.
No, because I've never tried to get her on Everest again.
It's a rough coaster,
I know,
though.
But it has sort of soured her on coasters in general.
And trusting you for...
But, I know. And she married me, right? But
no, it's fine. Yeah. But it's like, yeah, it's fine. It doesn't go backwards. And
whenever we're in Disneyland, she got on Matterhorn.
Oh, Jesus Christ.
That one is painful to ride.
She actually kind of liked that one. She's like, it's not too bad.
All right, Mikey, you're up if you have any more.
Okay. I'm finishing it off with Tower of Terror at Disneyland, because a lot of just a queue.
Wait,
not
hang
like,
on.
I mean, Disney World.
I was just
going to say. My mistake. Yeah, no, Disney World. I was thinking, you don't want them in Disneyland because they don't have one. And then I said it. No, in Disney World. And the
well,
queue music, not
one.
The actual attraction. They used to, yes. Not the attraction, mm-hmm. but the queue area.
Okay.
Because it's a lot of music from, you know, the 30s, 40s. And what they do is they play it like it was a slower RPM than it's supposed to be, which gives it an ethereal kind of quality to it.
Is this another YouTube find?
The Captain America song sounds normal.
No.
It's just creepy.
Are you lying?
Because
I don't remember
yes.
cue music for this attraction.
But there's cue music.
There's cue music.
They play the... You know the song Captain America
yes.
is dancing
yeah,
to?
Yeah, and it's normal.
Of...
It's not slowed down, though.
That part I don't know about, yeah. It just sounds normal to me.
And it's just
okay,
that one song.
If I'm wrong, then I just found a really cool playlist. Again.
Yeah, I think you found another good playlist because it just
that specifically said it was what it was.
I know the song you're talking about.
Yeah, it sounds normal in the queue. It's just
yeah.
old.
Yeah.
Well, I don't care. I still like what they play there and this playlist.
I want
all the music everywhere, ever.
I agree. I like the queue music.
So I win because I picked everything. Lauren?
Tiki room. In the tiki, 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 tiki room. And
I give you that.
Yeah.
I give you that. I like
yeah,
that.
That's
I think
fun.
It's fun,
that's
so.
It's fun.
I sleep through it, but it's fine. My last one would be actually the Jungle Cruise.
What?
The
what
queue.
Music?
The queue? Or
the queue.
The right, yeah,
mm-hmm.
with AWOL radio.
Yeah.
Because it's basically
mm-hmm.
just a loop of
that's
Easter eggs.
Exactly
yeah. Listen to
yeah.
when the radio broadcaster breaks in.
Well, I love them, and they change them at Christmas.
Yes.
Match the Jingle Cruise, which is
yes,
awesome.
Yes, they do.
All right, so I know we just had some fun talking about other music, even though we were trying to talk about Carousel of Progress. But I think it's safe to say that Disney, as a whole, they really put a lot of thought into what you hear when you're waiting to go on attractions, when you're on the attraction, and when you're just walking through the parks, because it's all about immersion and making you feel like you're somewhere besides the middle of Florida and everything else that's going on when you leave the bubble. I like the idea of the topic, and I hope we get to talk more about some of the music, just the audio cues and everything else that goes on besides the thrill of the attraction. We're not going to talk about rock and roller coaster. That's off the books. That's not going to happen. So don't worry about that topic coming up. That's going to do it on the topic. Now I want to find out what's happening with Mark. You came up with this. Good on you for putting notes out and handing them out to the class. We studied. We passed the test. Give us some closing remarks so we can get out of here.
Yeah, as always, I always love being asked to join the podcast. You know, any chance I get to record, I'm always down for it. I know we're not doing it so much anymore, but if anyone's ever gets a wild hair up their butt to join me on a flight, I'm always down. You can find it on the Three Sheets Gaming. Just searching the Facebook page, Three Sheets Gaming. And I know usually me, maybe Mikey, Tim, less so at the moment, but you know.
Lauren, thanks for all of the information you dug up.
You are so welcome. I worked diligently in the 10 minutes before
so
we started recording.
You showed up. You showed up, though. And G.I. Joe says, showing is half the battle. So you showed up, and I appreciate that. What are your closing remarks? Do you have anywhere to send people?
I'm on the Facebooks and the Instagram, and at least three of you have me on Snapchat, so...
Fair enough.
Hey, it was better than last time when she just turned around and says, "Don't find me."
Oh my god.
Right. All right. So, for some real meat on the bone, Adam.
All right.
What's happening, man?
So, the next thing we have coming up is some running group stuff. We're going to start with that. We have the Disneyland Halloween Half Marathon weekend. I don't know if we have too many shooters running that one. That runs from September 5th through September 8th. We have Walt Disney World Wine and Dine Weekend, and that's running from October 31st through November 3rd. I know a bunch of people are running the 5K because it's Swedish Chef, I want to say, or something Muppets. I don't remember exactly who it was.
Work, work, work.
Exactly. Our main sheet up this year is going to be from December 6th through December 8th. It is still unnamed, so keep attention to the page, and we will get that out to you. And last but not least, Dopey Weekend. There's a few things I want to touch. I want to give a quick shout out to everybody who donated to Will's page for his Dopey challenge because he couldn't get in originally. So he actually picked up a charity bib. And I just found out tonight that Mark is also fundraising. So I'm going to give it to Mark to give some more info on to how you can donate to his fundraising efforts.
So, like, yeah, I ended up getting a charity bib through Give Kids the World because they're one of the few charities that I came across that I've already heard of and I've already donated to, and they actually, one of the other few that actually did respond to me about, you know, charity races and everything. I did post a link to my fundraising page on Give Kids a World in the running group. If not, you can always go to my personal Facebook page, which has a actual fundraising page on it itself, which is already open to the public. So you should be able to join, donate to that. It'll get donated to PayPal and eventually it'll be put into my donations.
I, on the other hand, am the stupid one who paid for his full Dopey out of pocket. So,
I mean, it's in the name, Adam.
Stupid or Dopey.
Yes.
Yes. Yes. All the above.
I only want
to. If it makes you feel any better, Adam, I do plan on doing Dopey at some point.
Yeah. Okay. I didn't plan on doing Dopey this time. That's awesome.
But you're doing it again.
Yes, because Goofy was sold out. Don't get me started on this again. I'm very upset. Very upset.
We've heard.
But that's all I got. I really appreciate everybody for showing up for tonight. And I thought it was a kind of fun show.
Me too. It was always enjoyable.
Me three.
All right, then. With regards to the Facebook group, you can always just look up Three Sheets, the number three Sheets on Facebook to find us if you're interested in joining. We got this the barest minimum of what you have to do on your end to get into the group. Answer the questions, answer them honestly, and, you know, we'll get you in so you can start interacting with all these other Disney-loving adults. That's an easy way to find Mark. He posts all the time. You can find his fundraising efforts through that and then onto the running group. So, yeah, please come join us, and let's have a good time because we like to think we're a lot of fun. So come experience it for yourself. But that's going to do it for this episode as we get out of here. Thanks for listening along, and as always, this is not goodbye. It's see you real soon. So good night.
Good night.
Good night.
Good night.
And thank you. She went crazy with the spirit fingers, man. Or the jazz hands, or whatever you want to call it.